On to the technical bit, so this is where I get my geek on. Basically, when you are taking your photographs, you have a thing called the exposure triangle, which is the way you affect light coming into your camera. Now, it does not matter what your camera is here. It can be a smartphone, it can be a digital SLR, it can be anything at all. But they all have these things and they all use them to get the light right. You've got your ISO, which is going to be vitally important for you guys. Your shutter speed, which is slightly less important, and your aperture, which again, pretty important. And these all work together to get the light coming into your camera. In the auto mode, the camera controls all of them. In the modes building up from that, you control a little bit more. And the reason these are really useful to know about just a little bit is that they will make a big difference to how you work with lights. Whenever I'm talking about working with light, it's not about moving loads of lights around and all that. It's more about the light that you've got to work with and how you use it to your best advantage. Whenever you are using the smartphones, you've got that exposure compensation that I talked about. This is also on your camera as well. It will not work in auto mode. It will generally work in P for program mode. And I'm going to talk about the reasons for that in a wee minute when we get to the modes. But basically, if the camera gets the light wrong, do not be afraid to go in and use this. You will just either scroll up and down or left and right on your smartphone screen, or holding the button in on your camera, you will turn the thumb wheel or the front wheel. It will vary a little bit from camera to camera, but there will be a button somewhere that either says EV for exposure value or has this plus minus symbol for exposure compensation. When you go in and change this, you can add or subtract light, and it's really, really useful. Basically, if you're photographing anything, you never want to go too bright. You don't want to go burnt out because your highlights will wash out and you'll lose detail. Highlights are harder to fix than shadows. I generally tend to shoot a little bit dark. Pretty much looking at this as is coming off camera, I would probably shoot at the zero, but that's because I do a lot of work afterwards. Most people would want this kind of shot. So this is the camera reading the light. There's a lot of white going on there, so it's gotten confused and it's got it wrong. So you can use the exposure compensation to just bump that up a little bit. Get a brighter shot, get it looking nicer, get more accurate color tones and more accurate light. You don't want to go too dark where you're losing all your detail in your light. You don't want to go too bright where you're starting to lose your highlights. You won't need exposure compensation for every photo, but sometimes it is handy to use and it allows you just to control the light a little bit. So if you go away from this and all you want to do is try the P mode and get better just controlling the light a little bit in your photos, then program mode and exposure compensation, even that alone will make a huge difference to your pictures because it will just give you that little bit more control. So rather than the camera taking what it thinks is right, you can adjust it to suit. And that's really good. The first leg of our exposure triangle then is called ISO. ISO is really important for you guys. So it's the one I'm probably going to talk about the most tonight. There are a lot of numbers here, but I think I passed one MAS exam in my life. So you'll be absolutely fine because if I can get the hang of them, you will too. I'm going to send you guys a little guide to these as well, a little like one sheet tip sheet thing that I've made that I'm going to send over that Esther can forward on. Your ISO number, ISO stands for International Standards Organization, which doesn't really matter, but it is your sensitivity to light. It's named after the way camera film used to be rated. So you would buy a different kind of film to suit a different type of light. Digital cameras are the exact same, except you don't have to change the film. You change the settings in the camera. So if you're on the professional mode in a phone, if you're in the Lightroom mobile app on an iPhone, or if you're on the program mode in your camera, not auto, not scene mode, has to be program mode or above, you can change the ISO to react to the light that you've got. And why this is really useful is that it allows the camera to become more or less sensitive to light. A low ISO works in bright light, making the camera less sensitive to light. It kind of works in reverse of sunscreen. A high ISO works in low light. So evenings, nighttime, darker studios, things like that. What it does is it makes the camera more sensitive to light and you will get a fast enough shutter to get light come into the shot. So it's really, really useful for playing about with. Now you would think looking at that, you'd be like, you just leave it high and then it will work with everything. But there is a trade-off. Whenever you shoot on a high ISO, so this was shot in a low ISO, you can see everything's really smooth, everything's really detailed, everything looks really sharp. On a high ISO, completely unrelated, because none of my product shots were on a high ISO, so I had to find one that actually was. This is Kerry King from Slayer. You can see it's very grainy. It's very speckly. There's a lot of noise in it. So to cram in that extra light, a high ISO shot will sacrifice a level of detail. This is why ISO is so important for you guys, because as makers and creators, you want to show your work off clearly and detailed. You don't want to sacrifice the detail by bumping up your high ISO. So if you're shooting and it's a little bit darker or a little bit lower light, but your subject is still, get a tripod, keep your ISO lower. It's all about the quality. If you were maybe photographing prints or paintings to sell reproductions like prints, you need that low ISO to get the best quality. If you were doing anything you're kind of showing off online, same again, lots of sites now allow you to zoom in on products and you will see that grain showing up. You will see it deteriorating the quality quite badly and it's not going to do your work justice. So if you've got the luxury of being able to take things outside or move them towards light, then low ISO is the way to go. You'll get a good enough shutter speed in bright light to take a shot handheld, no problems. But if you've got maybe a slightly darker space that you need to work with, then get yourself a little tripod. Again, keep that ISO down nice and low, and using that program mode will allow you to make adjustments. With the shutter speed, is directly affected by the ISO. So it will go faster or slower depending on what way your ISO is set. This matters more if you're taking photos handheld. So if you're taking photos on a tripod, shutter speed doesn't really matter. It can go as slow as you want to get the light in, as long as your subject's not moving. I'm kind of going that you guys are all photographing still things. If anybody is photographing anybody moving or anything moving, shout, because it's slightly different rules. But for still things, your shutter speed doesn't matter. If you're on a tripod, you can go as slow as you want. If you are shooting handheld, you can't do that. Anything below about a hundredth of a second, it's surprisingly fast, starts to pick up a little bit of shake. So basically, you want to be always trying to get that hundredth of a second point. So if you can't get that with the ISO you're on, you would have to bump your ISO up or keep your ISO low and put the camera on a tripod. Again, this varies a little bit depending on the lenses you're shooting on and how steady your hands are. I do not have steady hands at all. I drink a lot of coffee. My hands are quite shaky. Anything below a hundredth of a second, I will pick up camera shake. It's undoubted. Whereas I know people can shoot down to like a 20th and a 30th of a second, so three times slower, and get away with it, no bother. You will know yourself, but it's best to err on the side of caution. Obviously, with the phones, there's a little bit less to hold. So you can rest your elbows on things or rest the phone on them. And same for cameras, you can rest them on things. You don't have to buy a tripod. But if you're going to be using it a lot, it's going to make it a lot easier for you. If you're shooting flat artworks, especially if they're on a wall as well, tripod will make a big difference because you can make sure and get it perfectly parallel so that you don't have any distortions. And then you're going to get a wee bit of extra info on shutter speeds in this as well. And then last but not least is your apertures. I should have left shutter speed the last because it is the least most important for you guys. Your aperture is the opening which lets light into your camera. So whenever you press the shutter button, it's controlling the light getting in. This one becomes important for you guys again because this controls not only the amount of light you get in, but the amount you get in focus. If I can pop this down a wee second, I'm wondering, will this bring me up? No, it didn't. I found myself a lens that I could open up the aperture in just so I could show you guys. But it is not letting me go in and out. 2 seconds. Let me see if we can get it up here. This is my old, I had to find an old lens. This is off the camera I started on. So basically, let's see if I can get it up. Oh yeah, you see that little hole opening and closing? There we go. That lens is stinking. That is your aperture. It works like the pupil in your eye. It either lets in more light or lets in less light, depending on the way it's set. Basically, as a kind of rough guide, low F numbers let in more light. High F numbers let in less light. So they work the opposite way around to ISO. The other thing then is that low F numbers get less in focus. High F numbers get lots in focus. So the easiest way to kind of remember that is low F number, low depth of field, high F number, high depth of field. And that's basically all you guys kind of need to worry about. This is an example of shooting on aperture priority mode. So program mode, you can control the ISO and the exposure compensation. Aperture priority mode, you're controlling your depth of field and your ISO, and you can also use your exposure compensation. For a lot of you guys, this is going to be the most useful setting on a camera because you can control these things. With the aperture adjustment, you will see that as the number below gets higher, more and more becomes sharp in the background. And that's basically your depth of field. High depth of field would be here with everything sharp. Low depth of field, here with everything blurry in the background. There's a sweet spot for things. You don't want to go so shallow that you lose the detail on your product. So probably around F4, F5 is a good kind of range. If you're shooting things with a lot of detail, you're going to want this slightly higher just to get that little bit more detail in there. But you can soften your background by either using a plain background or positioning your subject further away from it. The way this works is basically just, if you kind of look at this wee diagram again, the low F numbers are a big soft fuzzy beam of light. The high F numbers are a really focused and condensed beam of light. So this gives you a really focused sharp image, whereas this one gives you a lovely kind of nice fuzzy image. And you can see it kind of in practice here. So this one is a low F number, 3.5 or 4. So I've got one really sharp item in the foreground, softer in the background. It's brilliant for editorial shots because it draws the eye in, it minimizes distractions, and it lets lots of light in, allowing me to shoot this handheld. This one is a high F number, so everything is sharp. A little bit darker because there wasn't quite as much light to play with, but it keeps the detail in. If you're shooting prints, paintings, somebody mentioned paintings, things like that for reproduction, because your piece is perfectly flat, you will get away with a kind of mid-range. F5, F5.6 should work pretty well because there's no distance change across your piece. Sculptures, slightly different. Jewellery, slightly different. So I've got lots of little tips for those kind of through this as well. They will vary a little bit from subject to subject. But basically the things that are going to be most important for photographing things that are still, first thing, look at your light, get your ISO. Second thing, do you want a sharp background or a soft background? If you're going soft, F number low. If you're going high, kind of really everything sharp, you're going to get your F number high. You will see that your shutter speeds will change to suit those in the aperture priority mode, depending on what way you've got the camera set up. So you can play about with these modes. Program mode will control the depth of field for you. It won't give you so much control over it, whereas aperture control will. So it's your A or AV mode. Some of the phones do have an aperture menu in them now as well, which is brilliant. They do it kind of using artificial intelligence, AI effects, but it works really well. It's surprising how much you can genuinely do when you're playing about with the phones and everything that you can do in there. So it's really, really useful. Basically as well, then the one thing to sort of try and avoid as much as you possibly can is flash. It's not really going to be particularly flattering for your subjects. It's not going to work well. It's going to tend to bounce back and it's going to tend to change your colors. Flash is a really harsh, really white light. So it tends to look really quite hard on things and it doesn't tend to look good. If you can get a softer light, it's a better idea. So it's not something that I ever tend to advise, especially with the built-in flashes and cameras and phones. It's a very direct flash and it's slightly off to one side or on the top. So it casts a shadow and it doesn't look great. So it's worth kind of avoiding. The modes that are best for you guys are going to vary a little bit depending on what you're shooting. But like I say, because most of you guys are going for still objects, then a lot of it is going to be the ISO and the aperture. The ISO, generally as a rule, the lowest you can get it is the best way to go. So whatever you can get and get an achievable shot is the right way to do it because it's going to get you a lovely clear photo. More modern cameras will get up to about ISO 6400 before there starts to be a little bit of an issue, whereas older models won't do quite as well. Phones, again, the sensors aren't quite as powerful unless you've got like a brand new iPhone, in which case you could basically make me redundant. You can play about with it loads, but you want to do the best possible photos you can. Now, the reason for that, so I'm going to jump back and forth a little bit. The reason that you want good photos is that you want them to look really good across the board. And the better you can do your photos in the start, the better they're going to look. You're never going to take a bad photo and make it look good. On the Instagram, a couple of you guys asked about file formats. So your file formats, there are lots of different versions, but basically your phones and your cameras will generally default to a JPEG. A JPEG is just a generic photo file that is really easy to use. It's great, works across the board, it's brilliant. Hike is a new version of this, which is high efficiency image format in some newer Sony cameras and phones. Same kind of thing. A JPEG is a compressed file, which means, so whenever I take a photo on my phone, it's a JPEG. The camera will apply certain things that are built into the phone. So it will do the color the way it wants it. It will look at the camera or the photo and it will think, right, well, there's 25 shades of blue in here. There's 40 shades of green. There's 20 shades of yellow. I don't need all of those. And then depending on the compression applied, it will sacrifice levels of detail. So if you are doing like a print for reproduction or something for a catalog, you need lots of detail and your photo needs to be really really clear. So you should always use the high quality JPEG settings. The only time you want to use low quality JPEGs is when you're putting stuff online and you don't want people to be able to lift your images and print them without your consent. So low quality JPEGs, only really ever online. They're never going to work particularly well in print. Every time you do the edits and hit file and save again, the compression does apply and you do get a tiny little bit of loss of detail, but it would take thousands of times doing it for it to actually really impact the photo badly. So don't worry too much. If anyone's doing any really massive kind of pieces, then TIFFs are a large scale print format. The demand for these doesn't tend to be anywhere near as high anymore. They're a huge file. They're not easy to share, but they are the highest quality you can get. So some fine art kind of printers and things like that might use these, but that would be about it. Your RAW file is a type that you can shoot on the cameras that allows you to do more editing afterwards, allows you a lot more room for edit, and it has no compression, so it gets all the detail. However, RAW files need to be edited afterwards. You can't just save them. They're literally uncooked. They're not finished. So you can't just send them straight out. So if you're not going to spend ages or you don't have this sort of specific software, stick with the JPEGs. It's going to work across the board. Depending on what you might have access to, if you do have a Creative Cloud subscription, most of them include Lightroom and Photoshop, both of which will allow you to edit your images really, really well. I am a big fan of Lightroom. It's a little bit easier to maneuver than Photoshop. It's not quite as overwhelming. And it also allows you to organize your images in collections so you can keep a catalog of your images. This is something that's really important when you're taking a lot of photos. You're going to want to label them in a way that you can find them really easily. And this is really useful for this. Lightroom Mobile, like I said, on phones and tablets, absolutely brilliant. It's free and it's unbelievable. So no matter what your phone is or your camera is, get it. Totally worth it. I think I was sponsored. If you've got Photoshop, I tend to use Lightroom for my edits and then Photoshop for my detailed retouches. But again, it's a very hard program to use and a whole big thing in itself. But if you have the time and the patience to learn it, YouTube tutorials and things like that can be really great. I find for sharing stuff on Instagram and things like that, I tend to use Snapseed a lot. It's a great little free program. You can use it on your tablets. You can use it on smartphones. You can send images across to your smartphones to edit on them, or you can take them on the phone. It has a lot of the things that I would talk about in Photoshop. So you've got your tune image for adding brightness and contrast. You've got your curves. Your curves allow you to brighten or darken your whole photo. You can see there you've got your white balance. You've got your cropping tools. You've got a healing brush. You've also got brushes, which allow you to paint extra light into areas, brighten things, remove shadows, things like that. As a free tool, it's absolutely wonderful. It has built-in tutorials as well. So you can actually get stuff into it, play about with it, edit with it, and see what you're doing. And then you can watch little tutorials to learn how to do more as well. And for the fact that it costs nothing, it's absolutely great. And it will allow you to make those changes that you will need to, things like white balance and things like that. Generally, I don't tend to share anything that hasn't been edited to some extent because cameras and smartphones will tend to shoot a little flat just to allow us room to play with them. So a little bit of editing afterwards is usually a good idea. And then another thing which is a great idea, especially if you're shooting things like prints or paintings or artworks or anything like that, is if you do have a Creative Cloud subscription, Adobe Stock Photos are great for creating these editorial style images. So say you wanted to show off your work, how it would look in somebody's house. You can get these images for free. I think you can get 5 free a month, and you can Photoshop your piece in there to show somebody how that painting might look hanging on their wall. So things like that are really, really useful. Not everybody, let's be honest, like not everybody has a house that can go on Instagram. I live with a toddler and 3 cats. There's none of this house can go on Instagram. So this is a brilliant way to show your work off and show it to scale and show it what it would look like